subject today. Have you ever stopped to ask yourself, we were just singing a song about wanting to go to that land. Why do you want to go to that land? What is it that motivates you in a desire to go to heaven? Most of us, if presented with a choice, are going to choose heaven because we don't want hell. We know that heaven is better, but why do we want heaven? Terry spoke last week, and in his message, he said that we need to have a positive reason for a relationship with God. And that's what I want to talk about today. That's what I want our conversation to be about. I want it to be about our motivation in desiring heaven. I don't want you to desire heaven because you don't want to go to hell. I want your desire for heaven to be because of what it is and what it is like. I think our motivation in wanting to go to heaven is directly related to our understanding of what heaven is. Heaven's talked about a lot in the scriptures. Throughout the Bible, it's mentioned over 600 times, the word heaven. In the New Testament alone, it's close to 300 times, and in the Gospels, it's almost 150 times that heaven is mentioned. The Bible is filled with all of these symbolic descriptions of what heaven is going to be like. So I want to take some time, and I want you to use your imagination with me as we dive into this topic. We just sang a song about what heaven is going to be like. And I want you to use those words to build a picture in your head of what heaven is going to be like. It says that heaven is a land that is filled with love. It's a land that is full of joy, a land full of peace, and most importantly, it's a land where our Savior is. Revelation 21 in verse 4 puts it like this. It says, "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. From the former, these things have passed. For the former, these things have passed away." This describes to us a place that is absent of sorrow and most importantly, regret. That's the most astounding thing to me, is imagining a place where you can live and have no regrets. Because if you live life long enough, you accumulate regrets, whether you mean to or not. A preacher friend of mine describes heaven as there will be no wheelchairs in heaven. That pain and suffering and the physical limitations of this life will be gone. When you imagine heaven, what do you picture in your head? A lot of artwork depicts it this way. It depicts it as white, fluffy clouds spread out across the ground. There's this beautiful azure blue sky above you, and it's peeking through the clouds below you. I can remember when I was a kid, this was kind of the image that I had in my head of what heaven would be like. I would imagine that you would bounce off of the clouds like trampolines, except it would be so much more graceful, and it would be almost no effort, and you would just go soaring into the air, and you would come back down gently, drifting like a feather. A lot of people, when they picture heaven, they think of pearly gates. They think of people dressed in white robes that are just absolutely beautiful with no flaws whatsoever. When we start building a picture of heaven within our heads, the way that we build it is because of the things that people have told us about it and the things that we have read, the things that we see through Scripture. Our understanding of heaven is shaped by the Scripture and what we observe through it. So let me draw a little bit of a parallel here of what I'm trying to drive at, okay? In September of 2016, my wife and I moved to Arizona. And when we moved here, I had this picture in my head of what Arizona was like. I pictured a sandy desert, sparsely populated with cactus, sort of maybe some brown hills, it just wasn't really an attractive picture. This is a little bit of what I had pictured in my head. This is one of the places I've been in Arizona, and I had it in my head that this is what all of Arizona was like. And when I was reading through job descriptions and postings about churches that were looking for people to come and work with them in kingdom work, to come be a part of their family, I said to myself, why would anyone want to live in Arizona? The thing is, though, my picture of Arizona that I had in my head was far from accurate. It doesn't really begin to touch what Arizona is like. Arizona is a beautiful place. It's filled with green. There's wild flowers in the right season that are absolutely beautiful. I had in my head that Arizona was this place of blistering heat year-round, but there was no escape from it, and that's not the case at all. My understanding was very limited when it came to Arizona. I didn't have any clue that this state had so much elevation, that it had beautiful pine forests spread throughout it, that the heat only lasts for a few months, and the rest of the year is absolutely beautiful. And that's why so many snowbirds flock here. I love to travel. I love to see the outdoors. I love to see what God has made in this world. I think it's diverse. I think it's unique. I think that it is filled with beauty that's hiding in places that we don't even think to look for. To go back to my reason for even looking at Arizona, it's people. People is why we came here. Because we read an ad that talked about people who desired a relationship with God. And this is just a small snapshot of why we were so excited about being here. We have limited information when it comes to heaven, too. I was majorly misunderstanding what Arizona was like, and sometimes we majorly misunderstand what heaven is going to be like because we can't pull up a Google Street View and see what it looks like. We can't look up a weather report and know what it's going to be like when we arrive there. The things that we do know are found through Scripture, and Scripture paints a wonderful and beautiful picture of what heaven's going to be like. But it is a small glimpse of what it's actually like. It's not a complete understanding because I don't think that we're capable of it. It's not like when you're present at a place. I recently went to the Grand Canyon for the second time. The first time I went, you saw one of those pictures in there. You couldn't even see the Grand Canyon. You couldn't see it at all. But when you're standing there on the edge of the Grand Canyon and you're trying to describe that place and that feeling of being in that place to someone else, your words fall short. Even if you bring back the best picture or a video, it falls short of the description of what that place is going to be like. And that's what it is for us with heaven. We have amazing descriptions and understanding, but it is so pale and flat compared to what it's actually like to be there. A friend of mine, I was talking to him about this lesson, and he said something that I really liked, and I'm going to share it with you. He said, I feel like I'm an Aboriginal tribesman who's being told about an IMAX theater. I have no ability to understand what that's like, but you know what? I have goosebumps thinking about what the premiere is going to be like. That's how we are when it comes to heaven. We have an understanding. We're excited, but it pales because we don't have the right tools to understand everything about it. The reason that I wanted to start talking about a physical description of heaven is because it's a great way to dip our toes into the water of a conversation when it comes to heaven. And my hope is to take it from here where we can take a deep breath and we can hopefully dive deep into this conversation and understand a little bit more about what heaven is like. Heaven is about relationship. Let's look back at the passage that Phil read to us earlier. In John chapter 14, and verses 1 through 3, it says this, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, I would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go there to prepare a place for you, I will come back. And I will take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. I love this description of heaven. It's one of my favorites. It describes a home that's built with many rooms. Specifically, God's home. That God is building a special place in his personal dwelling for us. The house is a minor detail, though. Because the house represents what's important. The house signifies that there's a relationship, an intimate relationship between us and God. It says that we may be where he is. That's the most important thing about heaven, is being with God. We are described as the bride of Christ. We are going to live with our husband who has prepared a place for us. He has taken care of everything so that we can be with him. Let me try and frame this through a lens that we can hopefully understand this a little bit better. For those of us that are married, I want you to think back to when you were single. For some of you, that may be a long way back. For others of us, you may be single now. Guess what? You're in the right mindset already. What I want you to think about is, when you were single, why did you want to marry someone? Why did you want to be in that kind of a relationship? When we look at healthy marriages and healthy relationships from the outside, what do we see that attracts us to that kind of relationship? I think some of the things that we see are love. We see acceptance. We see support. We see companionship. We see this beautiful picture of us growing old together. For those of us that are married, we know that that is barely the surface of what it means to be in a relationship like this. We know that the best parts about a marriage relationship are those secrets that are between you and them. Those intimate things of being fully known by someone with all of your faults, with all of your failures, and knowing them in return. That despite all of the bad things about you, they choose to love you, they choose to accept you, but also they help you try and find a way past those things that are holding us back from being better. This is a small picture of what our relationship with God is like. We're viewing it from the outside. We know that wherever two or three are gathered together, he is there. We know that he is with us always. But heaven is more than all of those things. Heaven is being fully unveiled in the presence of God, to know him more fully than we ever could within this world. It's like adding a fourth dimension to our relationship with God. It is going to be that much better because heaven is completely and totally about relationship. If you look down in verses 4 through 7, I think we'll get a little bit more of a picture of this. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. The disciples were confused when it came to the directions on how to get to heaven. And I think a lot of us get confused about that, too. My first job that I had when I was 15 was delivering furniture. This was in the years before GPS, so you didn't have it on your phone. In fact, most people didn't have a cell phone, let alone be able to navigate. It was really before people map-quested, even. So when we would go to deliver furniture, we would be basing it off of the directions that the customer gave us and a good old-fashioned map of trying to look it up and find out where it was. And some customers were great at this. They would give you excellent directions, north, south, east, west, turn right here, this landmark's on the corner of my street. And I can remember other customers who came into our stores, and they couldn't tell you how to get to their house. And the terrifying part was they had driven to our store and didn't know how to get home. I had questions about delivering, whether they would even be there or not. I know what it's like to get good directions because for a while that was part of my livelihood. And the directions that Christ is giving to heaven are excellent directions. The directions that he has left for us are very, very good. But I don't want you to be confused. They are not directions to a place. They are directions and instructions about a relationship. The Bible isn't a roadmap to heaven. It isn't a set of instructions on turn here, do this, don't do that. It's telling us how to enter into a deeper relationship with God. And Jesus tells Thomas and the disciples, you know how to get there because you know how to be in relationship with me because you've been doing it for 3 years. You know how to do this. You know how to be in relationship with God. Getting to heaven isn't about doing and not doing. It's not about when you're in a relationship, you do the dishes because you're obligated to. It's not you remember anniversaries because that's what you do in a relationship. If you have a healthy, functioning relationship, you don't do those things out of a sense of obligation. You do it out of a sense of when you love someone, you want to bring joy to them. You want to make them smile. You want to make them laugh. You want them to be proud of you. It's no longer about what you get out of the relationship. It's about what you're putting in to the relationship. Heaven is hope. Heaven is joy. Last week, Terry shared a passage with us from Hebrews chapter 12, and it said, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus endured hardship. He endured pain for the joy that was placed before him. And I hope that today you have a picture of the joy that is before us. Heaven is what is before us. Living in a home with God. Living in a deep, meaningful relationship with the very creator of the universe. The being that knit us together in our mother's wombs. From what we have seen through Scripture, heaven looks amazing. It looks fantastic, but it's even better than anything you're thinking of and anything that you're dreaming of. I have one last passage to share with you from Philippians chapter 3 and verse 8. It says this, what is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ. Depending on your translation, there's a few other words that are used. Rubbish, dung, trash. The best that this world has to offer, the limited understanding that we have of what it is to be in a relationship with God, that is nothing but trash compared to what heaven is going to be like. That is the joy that is before each and every single one of us. I don't know if you have a need, but we are the body of Christ, and we want to meet that need. If you have a need, come forward as we sing.